the offloading modeling and offload analysis capabilities in Intel Advisor. So moving forward, okay, I have to press this now. Okay, so Intel Advisor is actually a tool with a rich set of capabilities. So I think it has been established in the last years as a very powerful tool for doing vector optimizations in combination with the so-called roofline analysis. We will also come to the roof analysis in the later in this talk. Actually, Advisor started many, many years ago as a threat prototyping tool where you could do modeling your application. So before you even started with real threading, you could model the performance try different threading designs. And somehow we are back now today also by adding modeling a tool. Part of the Advisor is now for modeling the offload. So to help you in designing your offload data strategy, but also then to understand the performance impact and what you can expect. In addition to this, there's also the flow graph analyzer, I think not so well known in the community. It helps to design, for example, task applications where you do TBB, but also what I myself learned during the preparation of this talk is that you can also design and analyze the flow in a program which does offloading. So for the agenda, then we, as you can imagine, we focus on the offload modeling, and then we go over to the roofline analysis for GPU code. And before we do this, I do some recap of the roofline analysis, and then in the end, I have some words on the flow graph analyzer. I don't see the outcome. Can I see the outcome of my initial poll?
Yeah, we have to start it. I will start it now. Well, this is the poll. Please give us some feedback about the usage of the Intel Analyzer.
Okay, so yeah. Looks like it's 50-50. So then perhaps for some parts will be for some people boring, for others not. So, but then I still have to go over the roofline model. Yes, thank you very much. Yeah, so let's start with offload modeling. But actually, I will not start with it now because I will do some preparation of the demo so that you can see that's really everything is live here. So in the material, you will find this so-called playbook advisor GPU nbody.txt file. That's just an ASCII file, and you can follow all these commands yourself. So the software is from the net, and you can clone it there and execute it yourself if you have Advisor installed. You do not need to have a GPU. It's just sufficient to have a CPU. And so I will go over this and start this because some commands of the Advisor take some time. So I have cloned it before. I'm now have opened here another in the terminal. I went to the code, and now this is the code. And I wanted to do not so simple matrix multiply example, but a more kind of real application. So a simple nbody code. And this is already threaded. So with OpenMP, we can have a short look into this file here. And people who are now molecular dynamics, they will certainly see what's going on here. So we have here an outer loop. Can you see my mouse and my?
Yes, we can see it.
Okay, then you can see it, all the highlighting. So you have here the outer loop over time step, and then the inner loop over the particles here. This is then parallelized with OpenMP. threading. And in between, we also enforce the vectorization. So simple things can be done by the compiler automatically. But then here in the lower ZIMD construct, you see that not the inner loop is vectorized, but the vectorization is via the outer loop. And here, so this is more difficult to detect for the compiler. So therefore, it is done here then explicitly. And finally, in the end, here we also have a parallel for loop, so for executing a reduction operation here. Okay, so let's make it. Files have to be compiled. So the next step would then be to look into the, just to do some simple tests here. So I set the KMP affinity equal verbos. This will give me the output about the how many threads were really started. So I just start the code here. So with the default is to go over 16,000 particles. I extended this here to 64,000 particles. And we can here see from the output. So this the first part is always an overview about the system. And then here we can see how the cores and the hardware threads there. And then we can here see how the threads were bound to the different cores. Essentially, they were not bound, so they can move around between all the cores and all the hyper threads. Here's the output. So we get about 1,100 gigaflops here out of the calculation. And I do a cross check. So I set an explicit pinning. So the scatter pinning here, just to check whether this has any influence onto the run. Start the run again. Now we see that each of the threads was bound to one core with here you see the always the two hyper threads in this one core. So the 24 threads were chosen automatically, because it matches the number of cores, and then the threads were bound to different cores. But actually, the performance is not influenced by this. So I will I keep the scatter, but now I do not need the verbose anymore. Perhaps also might be interesting comparing later to another test here is what is the performance of 16,000 particles. It's almost the same. Yeah, so it varies in the beginning a little bit, but then the performance is almost the same, only 30 gigaflops difference. Yes. Okay, then let's come to the real story, to the advisor. And to do an offload data collection here, these are the next lines here in the playbook here. So I take this, I will talk later about this also. There's a convenience script. So it's a Python script, and it's called run_oa.py. So it's in the distribution of the advisor. It's a convenience script. Actually, it will start this program several times and count several things here. And I select this convenience script here. I'll show you later other approaches. And add two additional flags here in addition to what you would normally do. One flag is here markup or OMP, so it will focus the offload modeling on loops which are already parallelized. Yes, and then I will also, by default, the offload modeling does a dependency analysis, because loops who have dependencies cannot be offloaded. They could in principle, but then that would run very small, because you would have to restrict any parallelization there. And therefore, it's normally done, and the dependency analysis. By just collecting here the basic analysis, I say, I give a hint to the advisor, there are no dependencies. And because we are focusing here on OpenMP loops, it is clear then. So let's start this command. And this will take about 4 minutes or so for this code, or perhaps because of the collect basic. It's now a little bit faster, about 3 minutes or so. And so I let it run in the meantime, and we'll continue here with the presentation. So what about offload modeling? Offload modeling in the advisor will show you in the end such a picture here, such a graph, and which finally should help you in defining which sections of the code are interesting to run on a given accelerator. And also it gives you some performance prediction. We will look into some details of this graph now. So one thing is more kind of a summary here. It gives you the overview of what could be expected. So here on the right-hand side, you see the measured time on the host, and then the estimated time on the accelerator. Yes, because you provide a configuration for the accelerator. For example, you could do an offload modeling for Gen 9 or Gen 11, or in what I do currently on the system is DG1. And with this, the performance projection is made. Also, what it measures is the cost for the data, the expected cost for the data transfer. What is the expected cost for the invocation? So this is on all the terminology is here. This is a tax you have to pay for it, and or even for the code transfer tax. And here the modeling was done for Gen 9 integrated GPU, and here you see the speed up of the accelerated code. This means really not the total code. It means the speed up of the accelerated parts. Yes, this is what is expected by running it on the GPU. And from this, then you can also be, when you know the fraction of accelerated code, or here the timings, then you can just calculate the speed up of the whole program. So the Amdahl's law speed up. Amdahl's law, we normally use it only for parallelization. So it can already be used for vectorization, because vectorization is for specific parallelization. But also, if you just think of running on a GPU, it's also because it's running there in parallel. That's all parallelization, and therefore can you use also the MDAT's law for calculating this number here. And here the total accelerated time is 1.63 seconds. That's just the sum of these two, time on host, time on accelerator. And the original time on the CPU was measured with 13.84 seconds. And dividing this, you also get the speed up for the whole program. Okay, the general approach here, what is the background of this is, okay, we measure something on a CPU, could be also together with if you have a program which are running already with DPC++ or OpenCL or OpenMP offload on perhaps the integrated GPU. These are the two different cases you can do. You can do just pure measurements on CPU and then do an estimation for the total time on CPU plus an estimated time on the GPU, so an estimated performance. Or you can run it actually on a GPU already, and then still you can do an estimation for another GPU. Yes, these both possibilities do you have here. And so the background of this is, the technical background is, you measure on the CPU, for example, you measure several regions, so region X, region Y, and then the estimation is done based on the assumption that everything is bound exclusively by compute. So just by comparing the compute power on the CPU and that on the, and estimating the compute on the GPU, you get this timings for the GPU. Then you do the same regarding the memory. So there you assume that everything is bounded exclusively by caches or memory. And then you have some additional tags which you cannot avoid. So you need it for the data transfer and also for the invocation of the code on the GPU. and this cannot be avoided, but time from compute and memory time, cache memory time, to just choose the maximum and add the data transfer time text and the data invocation text. And by this, you get an estimation for the overall region. Yes, if this would be executed on the GPU. And so with this modeling, it is decided in the tool then whether it is profitable or not to accelerate a certain part of code. Yes. Okay, and in the overview, you get a rough overview about the good candidates to offload, the bad candidates to offload, and also some bounds there. And yes, for the good candidates, you can even dive in deeper, and then you get a lot of information about the total time, the time on the accelerator, the speed up, also the offload taxes you have to pay for it. Yes, a data transfer. Then you get also information about the memory traffic. And so in the right part of the slide, then you see also that you clearly get also the view of the source code, so you always know where you are in this analysis. And what is also analyzed is what are the potential bounds for your workload on the GPU. Yes, and here for this example, it was shown that 59% were bound by the of the workload will presumably be bound by the L3 bandwidth, but there could be additional bounds. For example, also if you could solve this, yes, by this another architecture, then other bounds will show up certainly. Yeah. So this is just a specific then for this architecture.
There's a question, Kenan, in the chat. It relates to if you want to find out which regions are good for offloads, can one concentrate the profiling, the collection of the profiling on specific parts of the program only, so that you don't have to take a trace of the whole program?
Yeah, you can do it. That I showed already in the example when I started it. The first, there are different levels. The first level is, for example, something like markup OMP. You can mark up TBB. This is on a very coarse level, and in the moment, this Python scripts can only do it for this coarse level. Okay. People who are experienced with Advisor know that the real command is Advisor XE #CL. This is a full command, and in this full command, so this is actually called by the Python script, and in this full command, you can even just give a list of loops or just only one loop. Yes. Which should be analyzed.
Okay.
Yes. So this is possible. There's a flag markup list, and it will change its then selection markup, and then to give explicit loop. And meanwhile, it's very convenient because now we can even specify it just with the source file name plus the line in the source file.
I see. Okay.
Okay. Yeah, and then you get also regarding the data transfer, which is required for running it on a GPU. You also get a lot of information about this. So memory history, RAM, and then also specifically here, which memory objects have to be transferred. So the objects, the lines, the source line locations you see here, this is related to where this memory is allocated. Yes, then you can identify it in this way by knowing the source line. And here in the lower part, you see then the estimations for the transfer, for the data sizes which have to be transferred, and the tax in time, yes, which have to be paid for this. Okay. And then you get also, they will see several kernels or several loops, which will not benefit of offloading them. And there might be different reasons. So one reason could be a dependency issue. So when you have a dependency issue, you cannot parallelize it normally. You can sometimes enforce it as a programmer, so you still have this power to do it if you know that this that it is a false positive here, that it cannot be offloaded. And the other issue is here that an offload might be not profitable. Could be because of different reasons. I think in the first picture it was shown that this might be due to the L3 bandwidth. Here it's the expected computation time is high. Or also the other way around, it could be that the overall total time for this loop is too small. Yeah, and as the question was in the chat, so clearly, as a programmer who has already who knows the program in detail, you typically will have an idea which loops have to transfer, which have to be accelerated on the GPU, and therefore then you can focus on it. And what I can also say here already, the outcome here, what is profitable and not, it clearly depends on the target GPU. Yes, if you change the architecture of the target GPU, and then it will change, and we will see it in my own example. Yeah, it's in my own example, but also here already. So comparing Gen 9 with Gen 11 for this example, then it didn't benefit from Gen 9 because the calculation time was not improved. But for Gen 11, improvement is expected. So performance improvement is expected, and therefore it would be there would be a benefit from accelerating it. There's another view also, which comes automatically out of the analysis. It's a so-called program tree, where you can see and you can zoom into this, and then you see all the flow of your program, and then it's also shown which parts of your code should be accelerated and which not. But it requires a certain utility to be installed on your system. For example, it's not installed on the DevCloud. Okay, before you can start, what is required to use Offload Advisor? Actually, the -G, the full debug information, is also a requirement for the normal advisor. So Offload Advisor is not in an independent tool. Everything is integrated in just the Intel Advisor. It's just for convenience that we talk of the Offload Advisor and the Vectorization Advisor. And so -G is always required, because otherwise we cannot show it the information in a useful way. And then, so the Offload Advisor, it supports any optimization level. But here the levels -2, which does a moderate optimization, it does already vectorization, and the -NoIPO, it helps, yes, to provide the reasonable analysis, because for NoIPO, for interprocedural optimization, it may the Offload Advisor may be confused somehow about this, yes, and it's difficult to collect performance data for it. And then you have seen it a little bit already in the Jupyter notebook. Is actually it is a two-step, yes, One step is you do the profiling, so which is currently running, and then you do it in the second step is then the performance modeling, the real performance modeling, which is done based on the data which was gathered during the profiling. And for this tasks A and B, we have three different approaches. These are just for convenience. Yes, so there's nothing, no real different approaches. These are different levels of convenience. The most convenient, I think, to do this run oa.py Python script. Actually, what it does internally, it does a second alternative. So it starts a collection. And the analysis will do the performance modeling out of the data. And then for the most experienced users, they will just run it with the advisor xecl, so the normal baseline command for the Intel advisor. And then the analysis still has to be done with the analysis Py script. So this combination will give you the most control. Actually, in the backup of the slide set, you will find a lot of slides where these commands are discussed. And just also to give you an idea, yeah, it's always helpful also to use a minus minus help flag. Then you'll also get a list of flags. But as in the first introduction here, you can go look into the backup of the slides. Yes, and then you get this as output, you get a lot of files, for example, also report.csv file, CSV file, and with all the numbers in it. And out of this, the report.html file is built, which you then can look into. It's an interactive HTML file, and which you can then view into some browser. Next step is how you use it. You have seen it already, how I started this with run oa.py script. Here is the more in the more detail. So you have to source first the environment, typically do it already with sourcing the whole, I have to go back. Is doing it with the with sourcing the set vars.sh file from the one API distribution. It will then source all the source files from the compiler, vtune, advisor, all tools, yes. But you can always do it also explicitly. There's also the possibility you for not just downloading the complete base kit for one API or complete HPC kit. You can also have a link where you can download individual tools. In this environment, set up the environment variable APM is defined, and this points to the installation directory / performance model directory. And with this, you can easily start the data collection here. So this is a middle approach from these three different approaches. So here it start with the collection. You do the collection Python script. Then you have to specify a project directory. So this is created then, advisor project, underscore project, then there's a directory which is created. Then you define the target GPU. Here it's Gen 9, so Gen 11 is available, GD21 is available, but also you can actually define your own configuration file here, so you can define your own GPU. And then finally you define the application with options. Yes, here in the beginning you see advisor XE hash Python / Python, hash Python. This is not a specific Python, it's just for convenience. You can, I did it in the script so that you can see it. I just used Python. If you have a Python installed, then you can just use Python. So it comes with a distribution so that people There's no need to install a Python if you don't have one. This is the first step, and it, as I said, it takes some time because internally it does several runs of the advisor tool. So first a server run, which takes just the time, and then the collection, and with selection it counts it. It goes over the trip counts, it does a cache simulation, and it does normally the dependence analysis if you do not switch it off. And so it can take a long time to do a complete analysis, even for a smaller program. And then finally, when all the data was collected, you do the performance modeling. And so performance modeling does not need the application anymore because everything is already in this project file. So in this project directory, you have to specify it again. And then you can specify an output directory. It's not required. It will automatically do it somewhat deep in this advisor project. From convenience, it's even easier to specify an own output directory. Yeah, and then you look into the report file, in the report HTML file. And mentioned again on the bottom, there are alternatives doing it with only one Python script or even more. And with more detail with the advisor command line. Okay, because before we go into the roof line, let's see what our example is doing, our demo is doing. Okay, it has ended, so it took almost 5 minutes to prepare everything. So as mentioned in the beginning, it does a so-called survey call, which is just taking the time with as fast as possible. It will still influence the timing. There is some overhead, but nevertheless, it gives a good baseline, and then it will go and select all this, collect all the data like trip counts and cache information and memory information. Okay, what would be next? So the next would be just to open this report. Yes. So this is sort Firefox. Here I'm in the Jupyter notebook. I can open it directly. So here is the report. I open it. I have to trust it here, just in Jupyter Notebook. And here I see the overview. I will now, hopefully this will work. Yeah, I go zoom out a little bit. And here you see the different area. What is disappointing here, nothing was offloaded. Yes, it says, okay, there's no speed up. There is no speed up for the accurate code. Actually, it should be zero here, I would say, because nothing was accelerated. And so nothing was offloaded. And what you see here as an explanation is, I hope you can read it.
Yeah, that's better.
Yes, it was not profitable. So the L3 bandwidth was too large. The expected L3 bandwidth is too slow. And so if you cannot do it. So what I did is then I moved the slider here. So I said, okay, let's increase the L3 bandwidth. And actually I did it in two steps. So then I did the analysis again. And so I also have to increase here the number of execution units. It doesn't automatically update the view here. This is not possible. What you have to do is you can download it here, this configuration file. However, this does not work in the context of the Jupyter Notebook. It works in Firefox. Yes, I checked it also there. But what I did is just I opened here this configuration file which was created. Here you see the EO count multiplier equal to now, and then also the L3 bandwidth multiplier is 2, and so I copy pasted it just in a file, and so I have to go through for a moment. Okay, here we are. Okay. So I put this into this scalars file. Okay, I can do it explicitly. No, I don't. I will not. I will copy it from my backup. I did a backup. It saves time. So I have it here. I have a U-count multiplier 2. I have a 3 bandwidth multiplier 2. And now let's see what is the command. The command is, so I just redo the analysis here. Yes, this would be the analysis as before. If I just do the pure analysis, and then I add here the scalars file, and also have another output directory. So let's try this. This is fast. This will only take some seconds. Okay, it's done. So I can now open, I have to go to the another directory. Now I open this file and hopefully we will see that now that it can benefit from a faster architecture. Yes. So here you see then that something was accelerated, yes, and there will be a small benefit for the accelerated code, yes. I didn't accelerate already for the DG1, and for the DG1 by default there is no improvement expected, yeah. But for faster architecture we can expect some improvement, and therefore it might be worth to work already on this. For the second part of the talk, it was done for this NBuddy code. Yes, there is an NBuddy, there's a version for DPC++, and it's in the lower part here of the playbook. And you also can clone it, it's just in the normal examples. And I will also prepare this now. So we have to just say CMake. Then make minus J. And the second part of the talk is about the analysis on a real GPU. Yes, and so we are here now. I grabbed on the dev cloud, I grabbed a node, and perhaps you can see it here with SQL ls minus verbose that we have here. This is the DG1. Yes, you can DG1. You can identify it here by this code 49 or 05. This is the code for the DG1. Don't know whether this is already public, but out of experience, you can find it out by yourself. And comparing it also with Gen 9 or Gen 11. And then we will start here to run it. And we run this code here, also with 64,000 cells. And the SQLPy trace lets me show which drivers were used. So here the level 0 drivers were used by default. And I also get here about 1,100 gigabytes, gigaflops. So this shows already why there cannot be an improvement. So why the advisor is right in expecting no improvement on the DG1. Yes. Nevertheless, let's do the analysis here. For analysis, I will do it with the OpenCL layers, yes, with the OpenCL drivers. The background is actually I found a bug, either the advisor crashed with level zero, and I have to report this. But it works with the OpenCL drivers. So it started here. You see that OpenCL was used, and now what has been to be done for the analysis? For the analysis, we will first run this survey overview. So important is here, what is distinguishes it from the normal call is this enable GPU profiling flag. Yes, a part of the, from this, it's identical to what is done in a on a CPU. And so you see here also the impact. There is really some impact on the measured gigaflops rate here. Although it tries to have as less overhead as possible. And then I do the so-called trip count run. And this will again take some minutes, and therefore I will start it and run it during I do the presentation. Just give him some seconds here. Okay, so I start now the trip counts. Together in the trip counts, the stack analysis is done and also the flops are counted. And again, with GPU profiling enabled. Okay, going back to the presentation. So several of you answered that they're not familiar with the roofline analysis, and I can understand it. And therefore, I do just a short recap of it. So roofline is a chart that is integrated in Advisor, and what it will show you is you how your program is performing against some hardware limits, and you will detect by this your bottlenecks, and also how much performance is being left on the table, and gives you ideas what will be the next steps. You see it already here on the right. Side, yeah, you have horizontal lines, they say scalar at peak, vector at peak, vector fused multiplier and at peak. So you see here several lines here. Here for the vector, it's double position, both. And then you see diagonal lines, there are specification here is DRAM bandwidth, L3 bandwidth, L2 bandwidth, L1 bandwidth. Actually, this is a roofline chart for a CPU. And on the x-axis and on the y-axis, you see here it's arithmetic intensity on the x-axis and gigaflop rate on the y-axis. And this is somewhat surprising because how can bandwidths is related to gigaflops. Yes, how can both of these lines, different lines, be in this chart here? And what is the basis of the charts? The basis of the charts is actually not some theoretical numbers from the description of a processor. These are measured numbers. So the values of the roof lines, they are measured when you start a roofline analysis. These are very small benchmarks, and they run automatically. Okay, here you see also the references for the people who first invented this. And now I will explain it a little bit. So you have to this in certain architectures, you have to two hardware limitations. One is a peak flop rate, and the one other is a peak bandwidth rate. Yes, and how can I, it's clear that the peak flop rate is an absolute upper bound. And the bandwidth rate, how can I calculate a flop rate out of it? It's just by multiplied it with the arithmetic intensity. So in a loop, you will load and store an amount of memory, and then you will also do some calculations. And the number of calculations per byte, this is the arithmetic intensity. And if I multiply it with a platform bandwidth, then it's clear that the outcome will be a gigaflop rate. And this is then drawn in such a graph here for a very old model. Yeah, first I draw the platform peaks. This is the absolute upper limit. It's absolutely independent of the arithmetic intensity. Then I draw also these diagonal line of platform bandwidths times the arithmetic intensity. What is sometimes surprising that they do not cross the origin in all this graph. This is because it's always a logarithmic scale. Yes, so in this logarithmic scale, so the offset is actually the logarithm of the platform bandwidth, and then the curve is just a straight diagonal with step size one. And then you have a crossing point of this. It's kind of, this is a sweet spot here, because everything on the right, yeah, then you we draw the loops, we measure the loop performance, and for each loop, then we can draw this loop into the line. We can have the arithmetic intensity for a loop, we have the gigaflop rate for the loop, and then we can see here, because of the split in ultimately compute bound and ultimately memory bound area, which of the loops are ultimately compute bound. So if I do any optimization which is possible, any tuning and which is possible, and on the other hand I have this ultimately the memory bound area. Okay, this can then also be done for the GPU code. So in principle, the picture is not different than for the CPU, the principal picture. What is different here is really the memory levels. Yes, because we have here the DRAM bandwidth. It's okay, that's identical for the CPU. And we have here a line, which is the so-called GTI bandwidth. So this is the GPU is connected to the DRAM, yes. And then in the GPU itself, we have this L3 bandwidth, and then internally to it, we might have the SLM bandwidth, yes. And so, but part of this, everything is like also roofline analysis on the CPU, yeah. And it shows you here, if you hover over it, it shows you how much room you have for improvement. So you see here the measurement, the performance was measurement to 8 gigaflops, and here the maximum performance, because here this dot says this part of the loop, so the horizontal line is a loop, is only one loop, but distributed over the different type of memory accesses you had in the loops. There were memory accesses which went to the GTI. There were some which are bounded by the L3 and others bounded by the, you could then differentiate even in L3 and SLM. Yes, and here for these part of the loops which are bounded by the L3 bandwidth, you see that in principle it could reach here this performance, and so there's still room for improvement. Yeah. You can this view that you have this distribution of the that you see the details of the loop, you configure it here in this menu here in the upper part. You configure here which memory accesses you want to see, and then you get this idea on what should be your next steps about the optimization with respect to memory. Regarding the roof, what you are seeing, if you do, for example, just double position or just single position, so then you can click it, deselect this roof, that will make the picture clearer. What you also see here in this side menu here is that they see the values, what were the which were measured by the benchmarks in the beginning. And then you can also specify here the meaning of the circle. So what should be the meaning of a red circle, yellow and green circle? So it depends here on the timing, on the percentage of the timings. Yes. Okay. And yeah, so you have seen this in principle already in the example when I started it. So what is important here for doing an GPU roofline analysis on is that you enable it with this flag enable GPU profiling. As usual, you have to give a project directory. Then it's always reasonable if you do not run any advisor from inside the GUI, it's advisable to add here the search directory for the sources as an additional flag. And so this is just time measurement. And as mentioned already several times, this is sent for the for stacks and flops, and also cache can be counted here. And then the generation of the roofline report, then you have to add here the flag minus minus GPU. And then you can open the roofline in the web browser. Okay, before we go back to the example, I will close here the presentation by some words about the flow graph analyzer. So at the target was mainly in the beginning to give an design possibility and an analysis possibility for task-oriented parallel models, so like TBB tasks. But now this can be used also for DPC++, or it's called just SQL. Yes, and we see you see here an example on the right. Here you have four kernels which are executed on the GPU and using the access buffers here. And what the compiler will do automatically is, I think you heard it before in Igor's presentation already, that it will automatically generate dependencies here. It's clear that here the access for A, the buffer A here, and the access the buffer A in kernel one, it will they will have a data dependency here. Yes, the kernel 3 just accesses the buffer B, so it's independent. It can run in parallel to kernel 1 and kernel 2. And then finally, the kernel 4 depends on A and B, and therefore you have the dependencies for kernel 4 from it depends on kernel 2 and kernel 3. And this can then be visualized in the flow graph analyzer for DPC++. Yes, here you see the picture of the dependencies, and here you will be seeing then for deeper dive, you will see more information on this. Yes, but actually I did not try it myself. I just learned it when preparing the presentation. I had no time to try it, but it's on my list. Okay, I think that's all apart from the resources here. So what I highly recommend is to read this cookbook here. It's very nice and gives you a lot of ideas how you can proceed with Intel Advisor. And yes, as mentioned before, here in the backup, you find more details about the command lines. Okay, switching now back to the example here. So what I did before is the trip count. So then let's look into the next command, which I have to submit. So this is then just to prepare the actual roofline file. Okay, this takes only seconds, and then I have to go to this. Okay, I have to go up. one MPI samples, direct programming, DPC++, NBody, and I put it into also here into the first level of the project directory. I put it there. Okay, the trust. Okay, and here this is the outcome of this, and okay, here you see the measured performance, yes? So the measured performance was actually for the server run, it was in only 665.7 gigaflops. So it was less than the real measurements. On the other hand, what you see is, and what sometimes should not confuse you, it looks really very close to the upper bound, yes, to the peak performance here, but keep in mind this is logarithmic scale always. Yes, then you see also the information here about the loop, about the lambda here, and that by this you can identify it, the code line, and here you see two other loops which are less important. Here you see it also because it's only in green and small circles, which means didn't take a lot of time. Yeah. Then you can here, as mentioned, you can also switch on different levels of memory to see how this worked. Yes. So all of these were all not here for this loop. They were all not in a critical area here. So it was not bound by the memory bandwidth in here anymore. And yeah, here's the menu where you can see the measured bandwidths here, and where you could switch on and off different roof lines. And you could also switch, see here, make a different view for the loops, which loops were are vectorized, which are scalar. All of these loops are vectorized. Okay, what I final thing is here, when you do, for example, the offload modeling, is offload modeling, it runs on the CPU, and because it's a real advisor run, just collecting the data on the CPU, it also gives you all the information of a normal analysis with inter-advisors or vectorization analysis. And so this is shown here because I just downloaded this result directory, this project directory. I downloaded it here to my Windows laptop and opened it with the advisor on the Windows system. And here you see, for example, that this is from the first example, the OpenMP program, that actually this loop here in line 167, it was vectorized. This is here the OpenCMD loop. And then you see also, okay, the vectorization was AVX 512, efficiency was very good. And yeah, so this can be done. And also you can also see here the roof line, and again it's very close to the upper limit here. And by this I would like to close, and I'm open for questions.